So, why is it that modern movie scores seem to suck so much? I'll give you three answers in order of least impact to greatest impact. Loss of talent in the industry, pop scores, and the format of movies themselves has changed over the years. That has the biggest impact. Now, before I go any further, let me also say that I'd love to give you a video that has all of this music in it so you can just hear comparisons of this many measures and this many measures of different scenes in movies, but that's not going to fly on YouTube. If I do something like that, and I probably will, it's going to be a BitChute exclusive because of the content ID system on YouTube. I've actually done these kinds of videos in the past, and you probably haven't seen them because they've been copyrighted claimed so many times that I can't ever get them out for people to actually watch them. I've had even one where I show like a clip of Star Wars. It gets claimed by four or five different companies several times a year, and I can never generate any revenue or get any views on it. So that's going to end up being a BitChute exclusive. Let me just talk about the reasons right now. The first big one that I mentioned was loss of talent. All of this stuff contributes to the feeling that scores are not just bad, but that they're really forgettable, that people don't even notice that there's music in movies anymore or remember anything about it. When I say something like Star Wars, you're going to hear that theme start playing in your head. I could say the Imperial March, you're going to hear another John Williams theme. I could even say a more obscure movie like Ronin, and you're going to start hearing that Japanese clarinet. I could say Braveheart, you're going to start hearing the Highland pipes and different sorts of folk instruments and the melodies that they played in that movie, even if you haven't seen it for years. You don't have that in a lot of cases with modern movies. So the first reason, which I think has the lowest impact, and I almost don't want to say it, is a loss of talent. And the reason I don't want to say it is that even though I think the overall talent level of composers, at least in the United States, has gone down a little bit over the years, the cream sort of always rises to the top, and for the most part, you should only be hearing the top composers composing for movies, but there's nepotism and other things that get involved in moving people into the industry and giving them a chance to get their music out there. So, I mean, who knows? There's probably some low talent, but I know in general, universities have not taught a lot of the basics that are required in order to know how to orchestrate properly for a movie or write scores or just write music that people like. Composition schools tend to teach a lot of stuff that's 20th century and on, so modern and postmodern music that really, if you're going to be writing score music, there's nothing theoretically that happens after about 1910 that you need concern yourself with. So the 12th tone movement, you know, Schoenberg, Webern, their music's very original. You're not going to be using it in score writing because its effect is so minimal and so transient and can be replicated without using their particular composition techniques. So there's no reason for you to really concern yourself with it. Likewise, serial music, you're not going to be using that in a movie score. The point of a movie score is to support the emotion of the film. So there's really no reason to be looking at serial music or aleatoric music. It doesn't fit the purpose. But that's pretty much all of the academic music that was made in the 20th century. I'm not talking about jazz. I'm not talking about pop music. This is the kind of music that's taught in universities. This is the kind of music that's played in universities. This is the kind of music that's promoted to composition students, including myself. Now, as time goes on and you get further and further away till you have 100 years worth of music that has no relevance to the average listener whatsoever, you're going to get a dwindling of talent because you're bringing your kids, you're bringing your composition students into an environment where most of the music that is they're being told to create and most of the music they're having to analyze and learn and perform in their ensembles really is not focused on the consumer at all. It takes a different kind of mind to make music like John Williams and specifically go out of your way to do that kind of music. And I've met some great composers who actually do that. And in my opinion, they often are successful after they leave and they're able to do lots of different kinds of work in composition, like writing marching band shows and stuff like that. They're successful because they didn't get sucked into that culture of academia. They had a clear vision of what they wanted to do before they did their degree. But there's lots of students, and I was one of these to a certain extent. You get kind of drawn into doing this more postmodern kind of stuff that is not really what people want to listen to and isn't useful for writing a score. So the decrease in talent is the main one. I think there's a lot of composition students that don't have the tools that are necessary to write good motifs and good melodies in general. And I'll link a video down below if you're not a music student or you haven't done a lot of composition or you're a casual music student. This is one of my theory videos that just talks about how to write a melody, the basics of writing a melody. I give a couple of guidelines for writing a simple like 4 or 8 measure melody. If you can apply those and you can write a melody and it sounds good and memorable to you, you have to ask yourself a question: why aren't composers that supposedly have been, you know, studying their craft for years and years able to do that in a movie, and why aren't they doing it in a movie? So the next one has to do with really music supervisors and pop soundtracks, is that the studios are not wanting these classic scores that you maybe remember from Star Wars or Lawrence of Arabia or Patton or any of these great classic movies. They don't want a highly memorable, highly thematic score because they're asking for a different kind of movie, and more importantly, they really want the music to cue into people's sense of a pre-existing preference for music, and even nostalgia sometimes. So you tend to get a lot of what I call the pop soundtrack, which means most of the soundtrack and most of the music that you hear is generated from pop music. It's a party tune that the audience might be familiar with. It's a funny song. It's a piece from the 70s. It's a Led Zeppelin song, or it's a pop song from some era that people are very familiar with, and they put it in a context where like it happens during an action scene, and it's there to kind of add to whatever feelings that they're trying to get across there. So if there's a sad part, yeah, they play like, you know, they play a sad Beatles ballad or something like that. They like play Blackbird, and that's fine. But you see it over and over again, and it's a little bit of a cheap trick, I think, in terms of composition, because when somebody already has an attachment to a piece of music and you just play it for them, you're really not enhancing the emotion of the scene very perfectly. The scene is trying to convey one set of emotions, and you actually kind of muddle that by bringing somebody's nostalgic feelings or attachments to a song into it. I think it's effective in a sense because audiences often end up liking it and feeling attached to whatever was happening in that scene, but I think it's a bit cheap. And because it's effective and because it's so cheap, it's so much cheaper and easier to just license songs than to pay a composer a whole bunch of money to, to write music that people may forget or may not like, that you end up just going the pop music soundtrack. Or you have like what happened in Thor Ragnarok, which is where you have a composer that's just sort of imitating the other things that you've heard in the past from movies to make you remember how you felt. Like, so there's like a, you know, there's some Highland instruments, there's some folk instruments playing when you see Odin, and that makes you, oh, I remember Highlander being good, you know, or something like that. I remember Braveheart being good. So you kind of remember these instruments from other scores, but the instruments themselves are not playing anything melodic or thematic or motive-driven that you would hear in, say, Star Wars, like a motive that is attached to certain feelings in an operatic sense. That doesn't exist anymore. And a big reason that this doesn't exist, besides the fact that I think there's a smaller talent pool of competent composers now than I think there was in the past, because the Academy has done such a disservice to music in general. And if you guys think I'm exaggerating about how bad the Academy is with music, take some time, go down to a composition recital from whatever local university you have, and just take a listen to what students who are going to be receiving a bachelor's in music composition, what they're actually producing in order to achieve that particular degree. I know by the end of my undergraduate career, I was producing lots of music that I realized at a certain point, I'm like, I hate this music and I don't like the approach. I'm going to change what I'm doing. So go down there and just see it for yourself. Find the evidence of your senses. There might be some good music in there, but if the experience is anything like mine, you go down to like a conservatory recital, and it's like somebody plays like white noise static in a quadraphonic speaker arrangement, and that's the music. It's like, this is awful, right? And it's pointless. It does nothing. It doesn't do anything. So creating a great melody is like a technique. And that's why I would link that video down. Just like how knowing how to paint a face, if you're a painter, is a technique. Now, there's different degrees of skill and how you execute that to make a beautiful face or how you do expression. Same thing with melody. There's a lot to do with melody that's more than just the video I got. But that's a big problem. Now, the final and biggest impact, this is the one I really don't want to underestimate here, is the nature of movies has changed extremely significantly in the last 20 years, more than people realize, because it's been a gradual change. But just kind of like evolution, like each little success in each little generation informs the next production cycle as to what you ought to be doing. So movies have gotten not necessarily shorter. Like at the end of the 90s, they started getting really short, getting down to like 90 minutes. They're cutting out as much as they can. They figured out people want more story than that 90 minutes, so movies started to get longer. And so now you have superhero movies that are 2.5 hours long, which is quite long. But within that 2.5 hours, there's a huge amount of stuff. And especially when it comes to action sequences, they cut everything so tight together that you almost can't tell what the action is. You almost need a frame rate boost. You need that 48 frames per second to see some of the action. And things are so loud and so extreme, you know, and people want to blame Michael Bay for this, but you've got to blame everyone that imitates him as well. They're so loud and they're so extreme that there's no room for a motive-driven score like Star Wars, like what John Williams produces, even in a movie that John Williams writes the score for, like Episode 7. In Episode 7, the only scene I can remember having a real score-driven feel to it is the final scene where Rey shows up and hands a lightsaber to Luke, and the score is doing all the work because the story produced no buildup or drama to that particular moment, and it's just John Williams creating all the drama for it, pulling all the nostalgia for a shot, and then there's like a helicopter shot around that never should have made it into the movie. Like, the whole thing is, to me, very, very flat in as far as any kind of emotional impact coming from the movie, but the music is still good. And otherwise, there's really not a lot of room for John Williams to write great, great score music. And it's kind of the same thing with Last Jedi. There's never these quiet moments, and I'll link this one below too, of like the twin sunrise in the original Star Wars movie, where you have this kind of setup where, you know, Luke is longing, he goes up, and it's just 30 seconds of music and him staring at the horizon that lets you know a whole lot about how he's feeling. And the story has set up that moment, and the story draws from that moment later on. You don't have those moments in movies anymore because they're so much more extreme. And one of the things I think that movie studios have learned, if you want to maximize what you're doing, you really need to avoid boring anyone. And I think that's the big fear right now. And that was the fear at the end of the late 90s. That's why they cut everything down to 90 minutes. It's like, we got to get as many showings as we can in and bore nobody. It's got to be gone in 60 seconds as much as you can. You got to titillate the viewer and stimulate them as much as possible. And if you're doing that through lots of effects, explosions, loud noises, things like that, those don't go well with score. You can have big, loud, dissonant chords. You can have some, you know, the Avengers theme is like five notes, blah blah blah. You know, it's a very simple theme that fits with explosions. And so Alan Silvestri's score in the new Avengers movie works as much as it can in the capacity of that movie, because there's so little room for the score to do the work that it did in past movies, where you have a clear and present score supporting the emotion of a particular scene. That's been pushed to the side a lot in service to loud, noise-wise, a lot of stimulation, and visually a lot of stimulation that a score would distract from. If you had a beautiful score piece in the middle of something that's intense action, those things wouldn't really fit together. You're trying to enhance the emotion. If the emotion is adrenaline, there's only a few limited tools you can use to do that. And so that's really driving everything. There's less and less opportunity for the kind of scores that people consider really classic scores to show up in these big blockbusters. That's not to say they don't show up in movies that are outside of that, you know, particular sphere. One thing I will say, I don't know if you guys watch a lot of like modern Japanese movies, whether they're live action or they're like an anime movie. there seems to be a lot of room for scores, and the scores seem to be actually pretty good compared to Western movies. And I think that's just because they haven't taken the Hollywood approach to doing all of their movies. That's not to say that their movies are automatically better or something like that. But when I think of like soundtracks recently, I've heard that I thought had things going for them. I think they're all Japanese movies, even if they weren't like good movies. So anyway, that's some stuff to think about. Those are the three reasons that I think this is the case. Now, take what I said and listen to some scores in the context of movies. I almost never listen to soundtracks abstracted from their movies because those two things go together. It's one product to me. It'd be like watching a movie without sound. It kind of informs you as to how the cinematography was being executed because you can focus on one thing, but it's really not, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me to listen to a score absent its movie. Listen to the score in the movie, just kind of focus on what the music's doing and compare it to what you were used to before, these highly thematic scores. And John Williams wasn't the only person that did them, right? There's been lots of good composers in the past that wrote music, but he's like the last guy who's still doing a lot of stuff. Like Howard Shore's scores in Lord of the Rings were great, and they were great in The Hobbit as well. Michael Kamen did a whole bunch of great scores in the 80s and 90s that people probably would remember pretty well. There was a lot of composers out there doing that, but the newer crop, it seems to be, they're forced into doing this dissonant chord stuff for the majority of the movie, and that leaves the score feeling a little bit flat. So compare those and see how, when you change the movie, you change what the score needs to be, and listen to what's actually in the music, and you may find that it seems to be missing some of that spark, some of that sparkling complexity and beautiful melody that you heard in the scores of yore. Thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and I will try to respond to those comments. Leave me some movies down below that you think have great scores that have been released in the last 10 years. I'm going to start compiling a little bit of a list, and we can compare bad scores to good scores, build a little bit of evidence for my hypothesis here. This is just based on my observation, and most of my observation involves the big budget movies that we all end up watching, like the big blockbuster movies, and comparing them to blockbuster movies of yore. I'm not doing a lot of comparison here of like indie movies to indie movies. I think that would be a little bit different set of criteria that you would judge. So let me know what you think down below, and I will see you guys next time.